Okay, welcome back everybody to our second lecture on BC314 Media and Technology in Ministry. We've just had a little lecture on AI and its use in church and Christian ministry. Let me just read the comments that have been put in the chat. Divya has some things to share. Churches and Christian ministries can leverage the potential of AI in terms of increasing efficiency and productivity so as to reach a greater audience, to create content that can convey biblical truths in a creative manner, also feed LLMs with the correct scripture content. That's not done. The world can train models with incorrect data and can mislead masses. That is true. Also, if churches and Christian missions abstain themselves from this trending technology, there's a danger of becoming less relevant among communities that could heavily rely on AI in the future. That's also very important. That's true. Good thoughts. And so I think Divya is pointing out something very important, that if we don't get involved, we could get left out, and sometimes in some ways, especially in the context where people are using AI, and you know, it's becoming more and more prevalent, and I'm sure people are going to start developing tools, all kinds of tools based on AI that will basically run on our phones eventually. It'll just become so commonplace, and so many tools. And if the church does not get involved, doesn't engage, doesn't see how it can use it for advancing the word of God, we could become, in this space, we could become less relevant, less impactful. We could miss out on opportunities. So that's a good point. We must do our best to engage. Good. Thank you for sharing that. So now we're going to move into this last chapter. As I mentioned, we're going to talk about data privacy, data protection, which is important, right? So what we must be aware is that different countries, different regions have their own written statements and regulations on how data has to be protected. And in this space, the European Union is probably the toughest, strictest in terms of privacy, security of data, personal data, and a lot of other countries then follow, you know, and their regulations and their frameworks that they have put out. So essentially, generally, I'm speaking generally, like we said earlier, every country has their own written rules or policies or regulations. But generally, what is the intent or the motivation here is to protect people's data and to hold organizations who are entrusted with this data accountable. So if you think about a church or a Christian organization, the congregation or people, even beyond the congregation, entrust them with their data. Typically their name, numbers, phone numbers, email IDs, lots of other things, addresses, and it could be more. They're entrusting them with the data. So the organization then is responsible to protect that data, keep it private, keep it confidential, not be misused, not be leveraged for commercial purposes, other than the fair use that would be, that is agreed upon, and be accountable if anything goes wrong. So that it has to be lawfulness, fairness, and transparency, how this data is being collected, how it's being used. Limitation its purpose, that means you use it only for what you've stated that you're going to use, you're collecting the data for. And you only collect what is absolutely necessary, minimal amount of data. Keep the data accurate and, you know, up to date. And the storage, it's stored only as long as is needed for the specified purpose. Integrity and confidentiality, that means keep it in a way that's encrypted, it's secure, nobody else can take it and misuse it. And you must be accountable. If something happens, you need to report, or you need to inform the people who've given you the data and be accountable for this. So basically, that's the motivation in these policies or regulations that governments put together. So when we as a church or a Christian ministry, when we are collecting data, we need to remember that these laws or these policies apply to us as well. We can't say, I'm a church, you know, I'll do what I want. No, you're part of the country. You follow the rules of the country, wherever you are. And today, we are collecting data from all over the world, right? Because you're online, people from all over the world could come. They can give you their information. So you're really collecting information of people from so many different parts of the world. You are accountable. And it's true that, you know, you're operating in that country, but actually you're also reaching out to other countries. So nations could hold you or could do things that will hold you accountable, even though you are physically outside, but you're collecting data from people in other geographies, right? So they can hold you accountable or expect certain things from you and how you're handling data. So data protection, protect the data from unauthorized access or being taken away. So that essentially is what how you set up your database and how you store it, how do you back it up, all those things, which of course the IT team is responsible. You need to know. And then there are also the danger of malware. So that means external people, are trying to attack, trying to disrupt systems and trying to even take away data. And we keep hearing in the news, you know, data breaches that all happen often where people succeed, whether it's in a medical hospital data or whether it's in a financial data, whether it's in a corporate company data. You know, people are trying to attack and take this data and cause problems. They can hold others for ransom and so on, especially if they get the financial data, financial information. So data protection is one important area to think about. Make sure you keep securing the machines in which these data is being stored. Tell your IT people. Eh? So for example, I talk to our IT people, and our IT people are aware. Now we secure the servers in which the data is stored. We put them behind firewalls. We secure the ports, a lot of different ways in which, you know, we can secure data that's sitting on those servers. And then keeping it confidential. That means you don't allow other people to access this data and misuse it, right? So there are several ways to secure the data, of course, through using passwords and access controls. And also, let's say within your organization, people use the data, they need to know that they have to keep it secure. So example, in church, our pastors and a few of our staff, they have access to our church management system where we store all our, the data of all the people, and a lot of other information, you know, their personal data. So yeah, our pastors, everyone has, all the pastors have access to it because at any time they need to log in, if they need to contact somebody, then, you know, for the work they're doing. And then we also have, excuse me, please. Yeah, 1 minute. I just need to pause here. Sorry about the interruption. All right. So when we have all of the data, our pastors have access to it, our membership team has access to it, and they use it for, you know, their work. So they need to call people, they need to respond to various things, so on. They have access to the church management system, which has all the personal data. But they are aware that this data is confidential, right? So we're using it for day-to-day use to serve the people, but we can't take it out and pass it out to our outsiders at random, right? So that's our responsibility, right? As an organization, we tell our people who have access to the data, we're using the data to serve, also to keep it confidential. So let me just go back to the PDF. Yeah, so the confidentiality, you allow access only by authorized users. In our case, it'll be the pastors and the member care team. They are the ones who are making the calls or caring for the people and so on. They are the only ones who have access to this data. So keeping information about the individual private, keep it secure. They may not, you know, nobody wants their personal information to be given out to others randomly. So keep that. And if there is a security breach, for some reason, you know, if somebody manages to take the data off or misuse it, the law requires us to notify people immediately, as soon as possible. And of course, immediately take action to secure whatever data is there from further loss and damage. That means we need to inform the people, hey, example, saying, hey, you know, we were storing your data securely as best as we could, but somebody has been able to break through, you know, our security measures. They have taken your data, and so please be careful. Right, so that notification. Now, maybe if you're storing, there are degrees of impact that can happen. You know, if you're storing just, you know, contact details and maybe birthdays and anniversaries, okay, that's one degree. But if you're storing personal information like bank details and others, that's very serious, right? If that data is breached, that's very serious, right? So financial information is very serious. So, but the thing is, you have to notify the people. If something goes wrong, it's a responsibility to notify people. So just keep these things in mind as a church, as a ministry. When we are collecting data, we need to be responsible. We need to protect the data. We need to keep it confidential, keep it private. And if something goes wrong, we need to notify the people, inform them, and you know, respond to that. Okay. And it's a quick, short lesson, but it's a closing lesson. It's something for us to be mindful about when we set up our software systems and all of that as we collect data. Any questions on this? Okay. So this brings us to the completion of this course on media and technology. Just a few words in review. So basically, we started out this course by saying that the way things are, huge numbers of the world's population are engaging with media and technology. And we can see current data online, which means the church also must engage in this space. The church also must, you know, leverage media and technology and not be left out, but engage very meaningfully with people. And we started off by giving some guidelines that we can, the tools and the methods may change, but the message is the same. The message is the gospel of Jesus Christ, to be delivered by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's how we go about things. And then we, you know, the tools and methods will keep evolving. There may be new tools, who knows? 5 years from now, something new might come up. We don't know. But the message is the same. And our dependence is on the Holy Spirit. And there are standards by which we govern ourselves as we use these tools and technologies. So we started with some basic things of how things have changed in the contemporary church, in the sermon that's being preached, in the worship, in the gathering place, in the manner in which communication happens. Things have changed. And the goal is to be relevant. The goal is to be impactful. We keep preaching the same message. And we keep adapting to the, you know, the changes. But the goal is, you know, let's reach people. And then we started talking about different tools, right from looking at radio, television, drama, music, theater, arts, and poetry, and all of these things that have been used over time to minister to people. And then we went into talking about digital engagement. So we want to engage people digitally. How should we position ourselves? You know, we gave some simple guidance on understanding your congregation, understanding the people, where are they engaging, and how do you meaningfully engage? How do you engage meaningfully on various platforms? And then we started getting into some details. We talked about the various technologies or tools that we could use, the equipment that we could use, digital equipment that we could use. So we went through right from starting from basic photography, audio, video production, live streaming. So we went through all of that. I just gave you some information. It's very difficult to give everybody everything they need because it varies, you know, it all varies from place to place and context to context. But general idea, like this is what you would need to do these things in your church or ministry. And then we also talked a little bit about software platforms that we use. I just kind of shared with you some of the things that we use here at APC. And then we closed out just today by talking a little bit about AI and data production, data privacy. So we've covered a lot of ground, but I hope this gives you the impetus that, yeah, let us use media and technology for ministry, encourage the development of those skills. That means there'll be people around you, encourage them. Hey, you develop the right skills so that you can make use of, you know, whatever technology, whatever, use it. And then think of ways, creative ways by which you can use those tools, those technologies, media, to reach people, right? So with this, we will close this course. And next week, I will work on putting out an assignment. It's a non-technical assignment. I'm not going to ask you any technical questions. It's just for us to do a full review, all right, of this entire course. So you keep your PDFs open, and you can just as a review, a revision, you know, go through everything and answer the questions. It should not take you more than 1 hour, maximum 1.5 hours, 2 hours to do the assignment. And the assignment will then give you a grade for the course, okay? The assignment will be simple. It's based on, you know, whatever we discussed. It will be non-technical, so I'm not asking, couldn't expect you to know technical information because we have a mix of people here. And once we put out that assessment, you will, it'll be on Google Classroom, so you'll be notified and you can work on it. And with that, we will close, right? Any questions? Anybody has any questions before we pray and dismiss? Any comments? Okay. Let's close. Somebody could please pray with us, and then we will dismiss. Anyone can pray, please.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I come to you under the name of Jesus. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this time of prayer. We thank you for this course that we have learned, Lord. We thank you for the technology around us and for the development and for the knowledge and the wisdom and understanding you have given to us humans, Lord. And God, I pray that Jesus, everything that we learned when our ministry needs it, Lord, you will remember us, the things that we have learned, help us to apply it as leaders, as we go out, Lord, help us to walk in wisdom and understanding above all to glorify you, Jesus. We thank you for Pastor Ashish. We thank you for everything that he has taught us. And I thank you for all my classmates. May your grace, peace, love, and blessing be always upon us. I give you all the glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, everyone, for being part of this course. I hope you enjoyed this journey. Please look out for the final assessment. Make sure you do it so we get your grade, and we'll be done with that. Thank you so much. See you tomorrow. God bless. Bye.